Hi, I'm broadcaster and critic Jamie East, standing on my soapbox telling you why you need Ozark in your life. Open up. Ozark, which has just launched its third season, is a crime thriller the likes of which you haven't seen before. It takes its name from the resort in Missouri in which it's set, although some people call it the Redneck Riviera. There's a lot of money, but not a whole lot of teeth. When we first meet him, Marty Bird is a Chicago-based accountant involved in dubious activities for the Mexican drug cartel. A series of unfortunate events leads him to have to relocate his very reluctant family, wife Wendy, kids Charlotte and Jonah, to the resort of Ozark in order to begin a huge money laundering operation in order to save their lives. Ozark was chosen as a super last-minute destination after Marty remembered having a flyer for it in his pocket.
This place, it's away from every single law enforcement agency in the U.S., and it's cash rich.
This is the first time we see that Marty's decisions aren't always based on a whole lot of thought. Its coastline and relatively sleepy reputation is seen as the perfect place for the cartel to clean their cash. As the mysterious and somewhat rich Birds arrive in their new town, containers full of cash in tow, the race is on for them to ingratiate themselves into the community and embroil themselves into the lives and businesses of the local residents. It's not long before their propensity for flashing the cash attracts the local criminals as well as the watchful gaze of the FBI, curious as to why they've suddenly up sticks and left Chicago.
Look, I need to know what the plan is with Bird.
Now, this show came along just at the right time for me. It was 2017. Breaking Bad had floated off dreaming of Baby Blue. It had been some time since True Detective Season 1's tracking shot genius. And apart from dramatic behemoths like Game of Thrones, there was nothing of any real substance out there to get your teeth into. We were all well used to the idea of the anti-hero. But what Ozark did above and beyond most of the series was to make pretty much every character their own Shakespearean tragedy, collapsing in on itself. Yes, Marty Bird is the protagonist, through which most of which life happens to in Ozark, but he also has the most traditionally linear character arc. Something happens, Marty must deal with the fallout of that thing, and then you repeat until fade.
Get the fuck away from me!
He may have the smarts to get himself out of almost every corner he puts himself in, but as we learn from the first ever episode, he's only there because ultimately he's rotten to his core. Much more interesting are the women surrounding him. There's Wendy, his wife. We first meet Wendy as an innocent bystander to Marty's actions.
Policeman jail time or witness protection program, the best if we even get that far.
If we make it that far, the kids and I are in danger.
Although she's not someone averse to taking family-breaking risks herself. Her transition from resistant life partner to active and equal participant has been swift, aggressive, and incredible to watch.
I was just wondering how you might feel about making some supplemental income.
Laura Linney's eyes do more acting in some scenes than entire casts have across whole seasons. This is not someone who takes no for an answer, whether that thing's a casino license or a drug distribution center. She is the silent assassin.
Shh.
Less silent, however, is Ruth Langmore. Ruth's been my favourite character to watch by far.
Don't put down anything around her that you're fond of.
Starting the show as a brattish young redneck held in deep contempt and suspicion by Marty, with that feeling being more than reciprocated, Julia Garner's portrayal of the angriest woman on the planet has been the series' unexpected joy. The downturned mouth and pure rage which flows from her offers some of the show's best moments. But it's the points in her life we, the audience, are privy to before she is that keep us on tenterhooks.
That cash isn't worth the paper it's printed on if I don't know how to clean it.
You're the smartest person this side of Mississippi. Anything you don't know yet, you'll figure.
For someone as morally corrupt and streetwise as Ruth is, she's still the audience's eyes and ears, possibly even more so than the Bird children. If Ruth's angry and confused, which is quite a lot of the time, then chances are we are too. She's also the character with the least to lose. She's the product of an abusive trailer park upbringing, and we're willing her to succeed.
I'm not about to take advice from someone who couldn't get past the 10th grade.
Oh,
She suffers no fall gladly, and she's got that twisted sense of morality that can only come from someone used to stealing their whole lives yet considers themselves loyal that Marty so desperately craves. If Marty and Wendy are running the show, no one's told Ruth, the whole operation relies on this foul-mouthed firecracker. Okay, can we now take a brief moment to discuss how the show looks, please? A lot of our favourite shows have a distinct style, an aesthetic intrinsically linked to the series. With Ozark, it's all about the dark baby. Everything about the show seems to have that weird 5 a.m. or 6 p.m. sheen to it, its constant twilight causing us to virtually squint through every scene. It's not an accident, and they didn't just forget to switch on the lights. Ozark cinematographer Ben Cutchins indicates this sparse use of movement and hyper-realism style was a conscious choice made by him and Jason Bateman very early on. Taking inspiration from early David Fincher productions and old Fujicolor film stock, the darkness is both a metaphorical statement, we're encouraged to wonder what's lurking in the shadows, what's floating beneath the lake's surface, to the less than subliminal act of making us actually physically lean in towards the screen, examining each corner for more information. Can we see someone out of focus over the shoulder? Who is it that's talking? Bateman's directing style, which won him an Emmy over many of his peers, is worthy of a huge nod too. His use of framing is vital in the complex storytelling here. If you're confused about who's on whose side, Bateman often helps you along here. It's worth taking note of who is literally on each other's side during pivotal scenes. It's a visual chef's kiss for you right there. I've also got a little theory that everything in Ozark has a slightly greenish hue because that's the colour of money. Jason Bateman will probably raise a sardonic eyebrow at that, but I reckon I've just uncovered something in his subconsciousness rather than behaving like a complete rando clinging onto a harebrained theory, thank you very much. It almost feels sadistic to make a show so dark when it features such incredible locations. If you remove the hillbilly heroin fields, the weird church congregation on the water, and the limpest strip club on earth, Ozark's set in one of those places your parents drove through by accident one Sunday and your mum was so taken by it you ended up eating lunch at the pub while she collected brochures from the estate agents. The bird's residence is so understatedly cool, Kevin MacLeod wouldn't mind if it was built on a tank of asbestos and plutonium, as long as that brickwork and glass stayed where it was. There aren't many places in the world with enough parking for a large family, room to pad a cavity wall with $5 million, a beautiful lawn leading to your own speedboat moored on the lake. Watch out for any electrical problems though there, kids. And a live-in grandfather figure who'll both watch your kids and get his meat and veg out every day. Why don't these places ever crop up on Rightmove? None of this, the characters, the locations, matters anything, however, if the story can't draw us in and keep us hooked. This, for me, is where Ozark really comes into its own. Starting with a boring man with a boring job finding out his partner is on the rob and his wife's cheating on him feels like you're getting a series worth of plot in about 10 minutes, but this is no normal show. It's all full steam ahead from there without ever feeling like you're being spoon-fed cliffhangers. What immediately becomes clear is that this tale is one that lives on its nerves and survives by the skin of its teeth. Marty's a man who self-justifies every disastrous decision because he's keeping his family safe, without ever really acknowledging that the danger was something that he created in the first place. His quick thinking and pragmatic approach to problems is his greatest asset, his uncanny ability to spot the logical and best, or at least the least worst path towards a solution gets everyone out of more than one hole. But being constantly backed into a corner means he's rarely as long-sighted as he needs to be, putting out tiny waste paper basket fires whilst pretending he can't see the building in flames in the distance. The revelations of Ozark's plot are revealed to us early on, but it's the human consequences that surprise, shock, and terrify us over the following 30 hours.
You think I just happened to be right next to you when I needed somebody who knew the lake? Huh? I found you.
As more and more unsuspecting casualties are sucked into Marty and Wendy's selfish and increasingly desperate survival plan, it's their actions and reactions that give the show its heartbeat. You know it's impossible for everyone to survive this, but in a town full of venomous snakes, you're not even sure who deserves to anyway. Ozark, an incredible story of greed and the cleverest stupid people you'll ever meet.